So is it visible to everybody?
Yes, yes.
Yes. So basically, the today I'm going to speak about the molecular markers. It's a new paradigm towards the in agriculture research. This is the slide which I have started my journey from the Dabhole Agriculture College when I basically belongs to the Kolhapur, and when I used to travel from Kolhapur to Dabhole, I used to visit the Karad, then Chukun, then Khed, and then finally comes to the Dabhole College. I think this can be the best picture to tell you about the what actually markers are. And because these markers are nothing but the this is the roadmap of the chromosomes. These are distributed across different chromosomes, and our target is to identify which markers is stacked for the which trait. The trait is nothing but the phenotype. The phenotype, that is the which we are seeing actually on the plant. That can be the aroma of the mango. That can be the your cooking quality of your rice. These are the all the traits that are, these are the all phenotypes. These all phenotypes are governed by the genes, and the genes are nothing but the they are located across the chromosomes, and we want to tag these chromosomes chromosomal segments using the markers. The purpose of this identification of the markers is to discriminate the varieties or discriminate to the lines. Also, it helps us to improvise the material, because this is always the greed of the plant breeders. This is always the greed of the humankind also, that we always want to have something better than the existing. So we try to develop something better and better and better. So to achieve this goal, we need to have what are the segments of the chromosome are responsible for the governing that trait is important. So towards the understanding this phenotype, these markers are basically being used. So these markers are nothing but the anything which can be used for the purpose of identification. In our daily day-to-day life, we are using these markers. Always we are using these markers. Just like if we just go in the market and ask for the go for the purchasing the mango, what we'll see, we'll see the mangoes which are having good aroma, the mangoes which is having good looking quality, that is its appearance and all those things. So these are, what are these? These are the only the markers of the identification or the discriminating from the inferior ones. So in daily life, we are using the markers unknowingly or knowingly in discrimination. So these are the genetic markers, and these are on specific locations on a chromosomes, which serves as a landmark for the genomic analysis. This can be the in human kinds, this can be the skin color, this can be the hair color, or if you just seen the happy space face spider, where the color coding of this your happy space is the morphological difference of that spider. Basically, these are the modes of the discriminating the one species to another, one organism to the another organism. So these are the actual markers. Then coming to the type of the markers, the type markers are the morphological markers, biochemical markers, cytological, or the DNA based markers. Now we'll see the markers in details one by one. The morphological markers are, if you just see the pictures, the on and unless, this is the one of the most important morphological marker in case of the rice, because the unless is not desired trait in now coming days, because it creates a problem while threshing to the labor. So the lines which are having ons, we used to discard from our breeding material, we used to discard it from the our segregating material. So this is the one of the most important trait in case of the on rice. Many of us will be belonging from the cotton growing area. So in case of the cotton, nowadays the coming trend is the big pole hybrids. The hybrids which are having a roundish shape or the oval shape, these are the another markers in case of the cotton concern, and if we are knowing the Rashi series is doing the best job in the developing such type of the hybrids presently they are rolling in the market. Another then in case of the cows, their skin color in the cows or horse colors, these are all morphological markers, and these markers help us to breeders or the molecular biologists to discriminate the varieties or the hybrids from each one another. Ultimately, the aim of this marker is to develop something which is more required by the community. This is the ultimate aim of this developing any type of the markers. Then another category is a biochemical marker. Biochemical markers such like, and the if you are just seeing to the screen, these are the Soviet heat unit in case of the chili, that is a hot pepper. Soviet heat unit is the unit for the measuring the pungency. If you know that the bargi is known for the less pungency, or the teja segment chilies are there, which are the known for the high pungency level. So depending upon the requirement of the geographical location, these hybrids or the varieties are being developed. To know this variety whether suited for the particular location or not, this type of the biochemical parameters are used. Suppose in case of the bargi chili, the Soviet heat unit is a 40,000, and in case of the teja, which is highly pungent, is having Soviet heat unit is around more than 1 lakh. So depending upon this pungency level, we decide which variety has to go in which location. Similarly, in case of the watermelon, total soluble sugar, that is the TSS, is a measure of the discrimination, because nobody wants that our watermelon, whatever we are purchasing, it should be a sweetness. It should be more sweet whenever we test it. So based upon the sweetness, this watermelon categorization is there, or the based upon the whenever we develop a hybrid, we will develop the hybrid which is having more TSS, so that consumers acceptance of particular hybrid will be the more. Similarly, in case of the gel consistency in the rice, gel consistency and amylose content are the most important in case of the rice cooking quality. If you had seen in the pictures that the Japanese or the Chinese people used to eat the rice within two sticks. Why? Because their rice is so sticky that they can hold it in a two stick. Because the gel consistency of their rice is around more than 60, and the amylose content is less than 1/6. That is 16 number. But in case of Indian cultivars, the gel consistency lies between 40 to 50%, while the amylose content is around 12, more than 80%. And in case of basmati, the amylose content is more than 20. That's what basmati is mostly suited for the pulao purpose, like this one. So these are all parameters that we are taking into consideration for discriminating the our varieties or the hybrids. Then coming to the cytological markers, the cytological or the chromosomal markers are the chromosomal variation in case of size, order, position, and the numbers also. Basically, most of the time we learn that the chromosomal aberrations are linked with any disabilities or the not to the normal cases. But sometimes it is also helpful in helpful. So there is one excellent example that Einstein is having one additional chromosome. That's what he was so talented. This is a very rare example of the chromosomal aberration towards the positive case. But 99% of the chromosomal aberrations leads to the abnormalities. The major problem in the chromosomal marker is a low polymorphism and needs a special techniques for the identification of these markers. Then coming to the disadvantages to the morphological or the biochemical marker is the morphological and biochemical markers are the product of the gene expression. We are agriculture students. We know that any phenotype is governed by the is nothing but G plus E, and environment plays a humongous role in expression of any type of phenotype. There is an excellent example that we faced in our rice breeding program, that whenever we screen our material in the summer season, The desk to flowering, that is most important feature in case of the rice, which decides the segmentation in the rice, that is early, mid late and late segments. Whenever we expose our breeding material to the summer season, its duration gets reduced down. So if I just select the material based upon the desk to flowering, which is falling in the mid late or the early duration, it may not be actually early duration, because when we expose it to the normal growing season, this duration is getting changes. So this is an excellent example where these morphological markers are not that good important, that helping us to distinguishing the germplasm lines and all those things. Another one example, that is in case of the rice, that is a neck plus deficiency. Neck plus is highly is expressed at the time of the maturity only, and artificial inoculation is literally impossible in case of the neck plus in the rice. So if you want to screen the material, we have to go to the particular location and we have to screen the material in a particular environmental conditions only, and everything is dependent upon the environment. If in case the disease pressure is not being developed, we will end up with the all varieties of the all lines will be the moreover the resistant line, but which is not actually the case. This is the major problem. Another thing is the basmati. The basmati, if you want to breed it in the basmati in the central zone, it is literally impossible, because to get the aroma of the basmati is not possible to express it here, or the segmentize that basmati lines into the good basmati or the bad basmati. So we have developed the markers based upon the bad gene. The bad gene is that gene is important for the having scent in the basmati rice. So despite of having if we have so using these bad gene markers, we are separating our segregating material to the basmati and non-basmati, and when in a drop whatever the lines which are positive with this bad gene markers are then tested to the specific location like Dehradun in Uttarakhand, which is the is ideal place for the expression of the basmati rice. So then therefore the effect of the environment can mask the genotypic effect, and the phenotype provides an imperfect measures of the plant's genetic potential. It's a developmental constraint. Development constraint in the sense that if I want to screen out the watermelon germplasm line for the TSS, I have to wait until the watermelon get to the start set, it's get to the maturity, then I will test it the TSS, and then I will separate out the material. But it is very time consuming, and I have to depending upon the environmental I depend upon the watermelon to get its maturity. But if we want the markers in such a way that we should able to discriminate in the early stage only, so that we can utilize that material for further breeding purpose or the crossing purpose. So this is the major limitation in case of the morphological markers or the biochemical markers. And another major limitation is that this is the limited in the numbers. The next one is, this is the most important, that is a DNA markers, that actually I am going to deal with this DNA markers. Since last 10-12 years I am working with a DNA based marker, basically in the SNP marker I am working, and we have developed a number of markers for all number of traits. Almost every trait in the rice, that is most economical trait, we have developed a marker for the rice. These DNA markers are the occurring in the proximity with the gene locus of the interest, and can be identified by the range of molecular techniques such as the RFLT, RFID, AFLT, or microsatellite or the SNPs. Means the these are the type of different DNA based marker, that is we'll see this different types of the marker in details. Before we start the actually markers, this what are the advantages of these DNA markers? Firstly, DNA markers are not the product of the translation, and therefore they are less affected by the environment. I am putting the word that is less affected, because nowadays there are some reports are coming out regarding the epigenetic variation. The epigenetic
Hello.
Should I continue, sir?
Sachin.
So DNA markers are basically, these are not dependent on the environmental condition, and they are less depending upon the environmental condition, because there are some reports has been coming regarding the epigenetic variation, and this is very minor, 99.9% these are non-depending upon the environment. But there are some reports that epigenetic variation is heritable also up to certain generations. This provided true representation of the genetic makeup at the DNA level, and there is no developmental constraint during the analysis, because if I want to screen out the material based upon the pungence in the chilies, I don't have to wait the chilies to be get ripe. I can screen it at a two layer stage only. If I want to do the TSS analysis in basmati in case of the watermelon, then I will screen it at a two layer stage only, and whatever the lines which are having more TSS, we will plant only those plants. So this is independent upon the stage of the organism, stage of the organ where it has been expressed. Because this is based upon the DNA makeup, so it is not dependent upon the developmental stage of the plant. The first one is the restriction fragment length polymorphism. The restriction fragment length polymorphism is the prime marker. Basically, when we don't have any information regarding the genome of the particular plants or the particular organism, restriction fragment length polymorphism markers helps us to develop such markers. Here, what we do, we'll extract the DNA and restrict with the restriction enzyme and load it on the gel. Based upon the gel images, we can discriminate the varieties from one to another. Nowadays, these RFNP markers are, though it is a codominant in nature and highly reproducible, due to the less informative in nature, these are being used in a less in a plant breeding presently. Because the but these are the presently used in rigorously in case of the transgenic. Transgenic for developing the vectors and insertion and deletion of the particular DNA segment into vector. These RFLPs are being used most widely. Then coming to the PCR-based marker, the, under the PCR-based marker, there are the markers like RAPD, random amplified polymorphic DNA, amplified fragment length polymorphism, microsatellite, and sequencing well, that is SNP markers. Then we will have this, some regarding the RFID markers. This is a first generation of the marker in case of PCR markers, where the universal oligos, that is a 8 to 10 base.
Continue.
Okay. So RFID markers, these are the universal markers, and the oligos which are length of 8 to 10 base pairs are used for the amplifying the DNA. Basically, when we don't have any information regarding the genome, research like as a, the crop, often crops where we don't have any information in a history, in that case, to discriminate the varieties, RFIDs are being used. The only limitation with this RFID marker is less reproducibility, because if you that is only limitation which hinders these markers in utilization in the breeding program. Then coming to the AFLP marker, AFLP markers is a amplified fragment length polymorphism. It reveals the high level of polymorphism, highly reproducible, and it is a combination of the RFLP and PCR. That is a here what we are doing. We are doing the restriction digestion of the DNA and followed with the PCR amplification of the markers. These are also we are using the universal markers in case of the AFLP, and the amplified product are being are dissolved on the gel that can be the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis or the X-ray based or the normal agro gels. if you just see this picture, this is quite a complex picture, and we used to see such type of picture in case of the fingerprinting of any lines or like this one. But there are very so less reports regarding to the AFNP markers in utilization in the brain programs. Coming to the next level of the marker, that is SSR. SSRs are nothing but the simple sequence repeat markers. These are the, if you just see in the picture, in this picture, there is a repeat of the CA, that is a dinucleotide. In first line, there is a repeat of 12 times CA has come. In another line, this is 13, and in another line is 16. So what is the difference of between 1 and 6, third? It is around 8 to 10 base difference is there. This 10 base difference we try to discriminate for the discriminating the varieties. Basically, these SSR markers are coming to the light when the genome was published. When the people understand the genome properly, they come to know that there are certain repeats present in the entire genome, either in the coding and non-coding region. And the scientists think that these repeats can help us to discriminate our varieties. So, taking to the these multiple repeats of this dinucleotide, the forward and reverse primers are designed. This is forward, this is reverse primer. And using that primers, these repeat sequence is amplified, and the amplified product is then used for the discriminating upon the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. And depending upon the differences in the basis pair, the variety is identified, or the trait is being identified in the SSR markers. These SSR markers are were used in very rigorously until 2010 to 11, because that time the SNP markers were not that much in use. Until the 2010 to 11, SSR been were used very rigorously, and you will find number of the articles regarding to the SSRs. These markers are the predominant marker, highly reproducible, less laborious, and requires less quantity of DNA, less robust, and is easy to understand the polymorphism, easy to understand the discrimination between the lines. So these are the major advantages in case of the SSR markers. Then the most favorite topic, that is single nucleotide polymorphism. Since last 10 years, I'm working with the single nucleotide polymorphic markers, and this is the excellent tool in identification of the trait specific markers, because the based upon a single base pair differences, these markers are being used, and you will find these SNPs across the genome, and more the number, more the possibility to link with the trait. That is only principle in the SNP markers. There are many example in case of the SNPs. If you are seeing this picture, in this one, this is one variety, this is another variety, and in this variety, at GC level, at G level, another variety is a difference of the T. That means this SNP is a G by T. So this type of the differences are captured using different techniques, and this polymorphism is is used to correlate with the trait. And its visualization is based upon the fluorescence marker. If you are seeing the picture, this is the Illumina picture, where the blue color, this is a blue color, is represented by the one allele. Suppose in this case, G can be the one allele, and T can be the another allele, and this is the T is a hybrid. Suppose when in case of the hybrid wedding, we are using two parents, P1 and P2. So one parent, if it is having G, another parent having T, is F1 will have both the alleles G and T. So this is the F1. So this is the fluorescence technique, and we can use it by the endpoint PCR also. There are some facts regarding the SNP that they are found in the coding and non-coding region. Of course, in a high frequency, genetic variation is a significant, and SNP close to the particular gene acts as a marker for the that trait. So basically, these are some advantages in case of the SNP markers. Then this is the some fact sheets about the lesson page. Basically, these fact sheets are the depending upon how many lines you are using for the sequencing. This is generalized. This can be vary according to the germplasm panel you are using or the study. So basically, in case of the rice, you will get around 2.8 SNPs per kb, and the rice genome is around 400 mb. So you can understand how many number of SNPs we will get in the rice. If you come across some recent articles in the case of the rice, there are 3000 genome has been published in the case of the rice, and within the when you analyze the genome, you will get a billions of the SNPs in that 3000 lines. So these numbers may be vary depending upon the which lines you are using for the sequencing and identifying the SNPs. Then the next one is the most recent, that is the GBS. The GBS can be we can term it as a new technique, or we can use it as a complementary for the SNP markers, because in case of the GBS, GBS is nothing but the genotyping by sequencing. What we are doing in the GBS is firstly we insert the DNA, ligate it with the digest it with the restriction enzyme, load it in on the gel. Separate out the fragment of the interest. Basically, 200-250 bases fragment is being extracted, because this is the limitation of the Illumina sequencer, where we can load it only up to the 250 base per long sequence tag. This then these fragments will we will adapt it with the barcodes, DNA barcodes. Then this barcoded DNA is loaded into the Illumina sequencer, and using this Illumina sequencer, the fast reads are the developed, and these fast reads are then aligned with the reference genome for the discovery of the SNPs. And this discovery of discovered SNP are being then used for the various analysis for the identification of the marker, genome-wide association analysis, QTL mapping, bulk segregation analysis, its structure analysis, species analysis. For all purposes, these markers are being used. So that's all. Genotyping by sequencing is a complement to the SNP markers. So this is some advantages regarding to the SNP marker, that these are the biallelic, abundant in number, high throughput, and it can be multiplexed easily. The only limitation is that it is not multi-allelic. The SSRs are the multi-allelic, because that is the same marker, you can discriminate 10 different varieties with the 10 different types of the amplicon size. But in case of the SNPs, there are only two alleles are there, because so these are the biallelic. The no dominant technology has been emerged for the SNP discovery validation. And the difficulty in a distribution to allelic variation from the sequencing error. Because sometimes there is some 0.1 to 2% sequencing errors occurs while the sequencing. So this can be the false positive SNPs, which can be avoided using the proper validation analysis, can help us to remove these bad SNPs or the error sequencing error problems. Coming to the resolution power and the cost of RFPDR, the less having resolution followed with the ARFLP, SSR, and finally SNP. SNP are the most powerful markers in present day, and the cost wise also RFPDR the less costlier, and while the SNP are some comparatively more costlier. But cost that is matters a lot. But in case of if you see the breeding importance of the SNP markers. This cost becomes cost benefit ratio becomes negligible, because the way of utilization and the way of its utility, it helps us to reduce down your time, it helps us to reduce down the generations, it helps us to reduce down the cost in terms of the development of the product. So all these are the positive factors which help us to reduce down the cost benefit ratio of the SNP markers. Then this is the roadmap of the markers, that how these are being developed. The basically RFLP followed with the RFPD, SSR, SNP, then GPS followed with the full genome sequences. Now the era of the epigenomic liberation, genome editing, that is CRISPR-Cas, then proteome and RNA profiling. This is the new emerging trends which can be help us in the future breeding strategies. Then coming to the application part of these markers, basically these markers are used in the genetic diversity analysis. Then in case of the breeding pool, like marker-assisted selection, marker-assisted backcrossing, genomic selection. The genomic selection is the most recent use of this technique, where we can use it for the line development and the hybrid development, parental identification of the hybrids. Then quality control, in a quality control, we used to use for the varietal identification and genetic purity analysis. We'll see its application somewhat detailed. So quality control, that is varietal identification. The varietal identification is this is the there are some malpractices also following we see in the market. When we take a time of 5 to 6 years to develop certain varieties, some people comes together suddenly they will steal out your material and sell in the market without doing any research. To avoid this such of the theft, so the varietal identification using marker can serve as a better opportunity to fight against in a judicial matters. Because what we do, identify the unique markers for the particular variety across the genome, and whenever come across any the dummy samples that is placed in the market, we'll get the samples, we analyze the sample with the same markers, and if it is found to be similar type of the amplification or the similar type of the allelic variation for the lines that we have developed, we can claim that this line is ours. So it helps us to protect our material, and this is the most important. The government should also work on, is also working to having genetic profiling of their lines so that they can protect their material and avoid the misuse of the material. So based upon this markers, DNA profiling is done, and this DNA profiling is done, then converted into the binary format, and the binary format data is given inputted certain softwares to find out the similarity index between the different lines or the line of unknown, so that we can know that how much percent similarity with your variety it is. Then the next one is a varietal identification, that is a GOT. In case of the GOT means drought test. In a conventional approach, GOT is being done by the morphological traits. Because when we develop certain hybrids or the any varieties, it is not possible for the any organization to produce that much of quantity. So these lots are being given to the farmers to produce it. And after receiving the lots from the farmers, these are being tested to check it is the reliability, whether the same material is there, whether there are any adulteration is there, whether the lot is having genetic purity, more than 99% genetic purity is there or not. These are some checklists for the accepting any lot from the farmers. So for this one, a conventional approach is that to grow the seeds received from the farmers on the field, check its morphological differentiation identification for particular variety of the hybrid, and based upon the genetic, based upon the morphological discrimination, or how many percent of the adulteration or how many percentage of the offtypes are occurring in particular variety, based upon that one, the particular lot is being selected or the rejected. So this is somewhat time consuming, and sometimes what happens that we don't find the time to do the GOT on the field, because time span is very less. In case of the bitter gourd, we receive the seed by the end of the December, and we have to sell it in the market by the April. Only 3 to 4 months are there. Another there is a main restriction is that bitter gourd is having dormancy about one month. So that depends upon the variety. So it is very difficult to discriminate varieties in such case. So DNA markers can help us to solve this problem, because we can have some discriminating marker for particular variety, and based upon that variety, this is the picture of the GOT based upon marker. This is P1, P2, and that is parents of the hybrid, and these are the lot lines where we are seeing one line is showing the parental band, that is off type. So depending upon the norms of the organization, how much percentage of the off types is acceptable, the that lot is being accepted or rejected based upon the percent purity of the lot. Then coming to the diversity analysis, these markers, you are seeing this picture where this is the cluster analysis, that is a near neighboring job analysis. Then this is a structure analysis. This is used for the contamination of the blurs in your lines, and this is principal component analysis. Basically, this diversity analysis is being used to get the picture about your germplasm line actually. Because whenever we used to have the new line development program, we should understand what is our germplasm first. So based upon the understanding the germplasm, we can design the new process for the future breeding programs. So if you don't have the understanding regarding to the genetic relatedness between each line, so it is very difficult, because sometimes what will end up we'll select some lines which are the very sisters to each other and go for the development of the lines. So whatever the lines will be developed, that will be near isogenic lines to the same parents. So it will not help us, it will not add on your the genetic value of your breeding program. So to avoid this one, if we have done the cluster analysis, structure analysis and PC analysis, we can select out the lines from the different cluster group, so that whatever the lines that will develop, that can be having the more genetic value, more variability, and genetic diversity will be the more, which can be help us in the hybrid breeding or the heterosis breeding. Then coming to the most important, the use of the markers, that is the marker assisted selection. The marker assisted selection, the use of DNA markers that are tightly linked to the trait and used to assist the phenotyping screening is the object of the marker assisted selection. In marker assisted selection, breeding for the specific traits in the plant which is expensive and time consuming. This can be the most useful where the specific traits such like as the if I want to do the phenotyping for the root, which is a destructive phenotyping, it is very difficult because if we upload the root, nothing will be left us with us. It's a quite expensive. We cannot afford to have the lose the germplasm lines which are having better the in the terms of the root quality, or that can be the trait of my interest, suppose in that case. So in that case, the marker assisted selection can help us to avoid the destructive phenotyping. Also, this help us the early stage of identification of the plants, and which has help us to cross the very advanced for the further breeding. The goal of mass is to reduce the time for the selection. This example for this one is that suppose if I want to screen the material for the CLCD, that is a cotton leaf curl virus, which is the major problem in case of North cotton concern. In that case, I have to wait for 1 year to get the material screened. But if I develop the marker for the CLCD tolerance in case of the cotton, I don't have to depend upon the environment to get achieved, because I can screen it the material based upon the markers itself in the wherever I want to test it, and whatever the positive material, that can only shifted to the particular environment. So whether the environment will support us or not, that becomes secondary. So this is the most important thing in case of the marker assisted selection. And the second goal is to reduce down the cost associated with the screening phase, because there is always when we are working in a private organization, it is always being taught that for every seed, we have to pay the cost from the organization pocket. So organization wants to be get the value to be reduced down, so that the benefit of the organization will be increased. So cost saving is the most important in case of the agriculture, because we are the totally depending upon the environmental and the seasons. So marker assisted selection can help us to reduce down the screening time and the environmental dependency, and ultimately the cost saving in terms of the cost saving. Then this is the conventional approach of the plant breeding in case of the when the markers are not being used, where the P1 and P2, the P1 is a recipient, where we want to introduce the gene. Suppose B1 is a susceptible, is a most popular variety, and is a susceptible to certain diseases, and we want to transfer the disease resistance in that recurrent parent from the donor parent. So what we do, we'll develop the F1 of that, go for F2, and the based upon the F2 screening, we'll screen it in a particular environment. Suppose in case of the salinity tolerance, we'll screen it in the phytrans. In case of the bacterial blight, we'll inoculate with the bacterial BLB genes, xanthomonas organism to the rice lines, and whatever the plants which are the resistant to the BLB, that we select it and go for the next generation. Likewise, this the process is being carried out until the desired line has been achieved. This is quite time consuming and very laborious also. So in support this one, this is the way how the marker selection breeding works. In the same case, that is a recurrent parent and the resistant parent will cross with each other, it's F2. And if you are seeing this one, this is the resistance band that is absent in case of the recurrent parent. When we grow for the F2, we don't have to need for the screen it on the phenotypically. We can screen it by the genotypic markers. And the lines, you are seeing the arrows. These arrows are the plants which are having the homozygous allele of the donor segment, that is the resistant plant, that we will select, and only those plants will be carried forward for the next generation. So in this way, we can develop our material very quickly, and we can come into the market very fastly. So these are some advantages of the marker assisted selection. These are the simple method compared to the phenotyping screening, especially for the traits which are the various laborious screening is required. Just now we have quoted the example of the root phenotyping. Then it saves the time and resources. Selection at the seedling stage is for important traits such as the grain quality can be select based upon the before transplanting of the seed, or the at the stage of the seedling stage only we can screen the material. And this is our routine practice where what we are doing, we are sowing the seeds of any generations and selecting out the plant at the nursery stage only. So that whatever the plant that will be having the positive alleles, or the plants which is having the desired trait, that is only transferred to the field. It helps us to reduce down the labor, it helps us to reduce down the land requirement, and ultimately the cutting down the cost for the organization. It increases the reliability, it is non-dependent upon the environmental, and it can be discriminated between homozygous and heterozygous based upon the as per the markers. Then these are the potential benefits of the mass, that is it's more accurate and efficient selection of the specific genotype, and maybe lead to the accelerate the varietal development and more efficiently used for the resources, especially the field trials. The next is the marker assisted pack process. Suppose there are different varieties are there. Just like us, there is an excellent example of the Suvarna, which was a submergible susceptible in case of the northern states of the India, where the flooding is most common, and that time Suvarna, which is most popular in the in that region, it is very difficult to get if it is submerged in the water, which is very difficult to survive that Suvarna plants. But in that case, sub-1 gene was identified, which is a submergible tolerant gene. And using this marker-assisted backcrossing, sub-1 gene was transferred to the Suvarna background. The limitation or the major challenge is to maintain the Suvarna, its quality, its adaptability along with the sub-1 gene is a major challenge. So this challenge can be achieved using marker-assisted backcrossing, where the backcross breeding is where the donor segment, only the donor segment is being transferred to the particular variety. We'll see this in detail in coming slides. In a conventional backcrossing approach, just like in the mass, the recurrent current is crossed with the donor current and consistently back crossing. This is the F1 is crossed again with the P1, that is the recurrent current for BC1, and each of BC1 each generation 50% band is discarded because based upon the segregation of the particular trait, the selected plants will be used for the further back crossing. And accordingly, up to BC6 we have to go because we want to reduce down the donor segment or the donor chromosome DNA segment in the our recurrent current. So up to BC6 we'll achieve around 99.9% of the genome from the recurrent current. So this is a normal approach for the conventional breeding. You are seeing this one. F1 is this one which is having donor target as well as the recurrent parent, and as we go on increasing the background generations, the donor segment becomes the reducing, and finally we will achieve the recurrent parent along with the target gene. So for this one conventional approach, it needs to grow a large number of the plants for the selection of each generation in the backcrossing. That is a major limitation in case of the conventional backcrossing. Introgression of the quantitative traits is very difficult. Just like a brown plant occur in case of the rice, it is grown by the two QTLs. It's quite difficult to introduce these two QTLs using conventional backcrossing because the amount of the population required for the screening, amount of the then its dependency upon the environment or the on the BPH and all those things are the getting limitation factor in developing the lines which are BPH tolerant. So in case of the qualitative traits where the number of genes are involved in the resistance or the quality in that case it is very difficult to go with the conventional approach, and recovery of the recurrent genome is less efficient because we cannot able to estimate the how much of the percent recovery it has happened in case of the conventional approach. That is that's what we can say, that there is some linkage track may comes in a conventional approach in developing certain lines to the back crossing, and it is difficult in a negative selection of undesirable genes and avoiding the linkage track problem. This is the picture how this marker assisted back crossing is being done. This is a conventional approach where we just now say up to BC 20 generation we have go for the back crossing and to reduce down the genomic fragment of the donor segment with the taking the target gene into the concern. But in case of the marker assisted back crossing, we just have to wait up to BC 2 generation. Of the marker assisted backcrossing to develop certain varieties resistant for certain diseases or the target gene to incorporate the target genes. So in this marker assisted backcrossing, what we do, this is the chromosomal map, and these are the different markers which are allocated across the genome. And this is the target gene where we want to introduce this target gene from the donor segment into the recurrent parent. So the question arises, why we want this number of the markers for the background? These markers are the required for the recovering the recurrent parent genome as earliest as possible. That's what these many markers across different genome are the being selected. And what we do, we'll select out the plants in a backward generation which is carrying the heterologous allele for the target gene and the recurrent genome for the rest of the markers. So what will it do? It will reduce down the linkage drag of the donor segment and achieve the recovery of the recurrent parent earliest. So this is the conventional backcrossing and the marker assisted backcrossing. Where what we do, we will screen the P1, we will cross P1 and P2. Is F1 will cross with the again recurrent parent. Is background generation will be grown in the field, and the plants which are showing the positive for the your phenotype is selected, and for those plants only for the backcrossing is being done. But in case of the marker assisted backcrossing, will cross for the BC1 and select out the plants which is carrying the target gene and the less genome from the donor. donor segment. This is the plan which is ideal for the next pack crossing because it is having less genome of the donor segment and more genome of the recurrent parent along with the target gene of the my interest. The advantage of the marker-assisted pack crossing is that it saves time. Just now we see how much generations we are saving in the marker-assisted pack crossing. Then when phenotyping screening is expensive and difficult, this can be served as the best source for the next level of screening. Then when the selected traits is expressed in late in the development stage, like just like a few flower features, marker-assisted pack cross is the only approach. Just now I just quoted one example regarding to the neck blast screening because neck blast is seen when the plants is at a maturity stage. Its brain has already been developed. Then we cannot go for the conventional back crossing in case of the neck blast. So if we had a markers for the neck blast tolerance, we don't have to wait until the disease comes. We will screen it early stage, select out the plant which is having neck blast tolerant gene and go for the further back crossing. This is the major advantage in case of the marker assisted back crossing. Then next, the most important and the coming era breeding tool, that is the genomic selection. Genomic selection is a new approach for improving the quantitative trait in a large breeding population that uses the whole genome of molecular markers. This is basically genomic selection is being used for the line development and the hybrid prediction in a breeding program. In genomic selection, the method is to estimate the breeding value of the individual based upon the many markers distributed across the genome. And the primary benefit of the GS selection can be imposed by the quantitative traits in very early in a breeding process. And this is being used for the line development and hybrid breeding. Basically, in case of the genomic selection, genomic estimated breeding value, that is GSBV, is being calculated. And based upon the genomic estimated breeding value, the selection of the rejection of the plants is done. Where some complex statistical model is being used for the calculation of the genomic estimated breeding value. In this genomic selection, what we are doing, we are phenotyping, there are two populations are there, basically, a training population and the breeding population. Training population is the population where we have to train our the statistical model for the estimation of the genomic selection value. So based upon the phenotype and the genotypic value of the training population, this this model has been optimized, and this model is further used for untested population where we don't have to go for the phenotyping. Based upon the this model, we can select or reject the plants on the field. Basically, this is used when we have to screen a large number of the population with a limited time, genomic selection is being used. And if you just look at the literature in present era, there are references you will get in the genomic selection for the hybrid breeding or the hybrid line development. So this is the pipeline of the genomic selection, how it is done. Firstly, genotyping and the phenotyping of the training population is done. Based upon this genotyping and phenotyping, the model optimization, that is the genomic selection model optimization, is being done. Then, based upon the model optimization, genomic estimation breeding value is being calculated for the untested population. And finally, based upon the genomic breeding value, the selection will be carried out. Then coming to the these are the all things regarding to the markers in our breeding program, and this is some small some few slides of where how we are using these markers in our rice breeding program. This is the example of the marker assisted back crossing. In case of the bacterial blight, this is most important trait which reduces on the photosynthetic area. It affects on the leaf and it reduces on the photosynthetic area. It reduces the 1000 grain weight, that is test spread. It reduces the grain quality, choppiness, and yield loss is up to 20 to 50%. You are seeing this one. This is the symptoms of the bacterial blight, and this is the plot which is affected by the bacterial blight. The main objective is that to study the effectiveness of the different R genes and to design breeding strategy for a durable resistance, to develop the resistant cultivar through integrated approach. In this one, firstly we understand the genetic variability of the population, structure of the pathogen, study the pathogen epidemiology, effect to identify the R gene combinations, determine the quality of the resistant genes, and we incorporate the resistant into the high-yield cultivars which are susceptible to the bacterial blight. Basically, these are the different R genes that has been reported in the literature. So there are many R genes. There are few more R genes have been reported just now. So we screen out the material for different R genes. Firstly, and find out the efficacy of the different R genes. R genes in our bacterial blight pathogen, and based upon this, some genes have been shortlisted, and these genes are being further used for the backcrossing. So this was the strategy. In the our elite variety was crossed with the donor variety. This elite variety was then backcrossed with the elite parent. The selection of the R gene was based upon the markers. Then BLB screening of the selected plant was done, and followed with the MABC of the selected plants to find out the plants which are having less genome from the donor segment. This was carried forward. This was repeated until BC2, BC3 generation, similar fashion. And after BC3 generation, at the BC4, we are almost nullified the donor segment from the elite variety, and just only target gene was present in the elite variety. This was the artificial inoculation of the bacterial blight, and this was the ultimate outcome of our the study. Here, this is the line which is the recurrent parent basically, which was susceptible for the disease for the bacterial blight, and finally we end up with the same variety which is highly resistant for the bacterial blight. This was a good success story in case of the utilization of the properly or successful utilization of the markers in a developing of the material. And using these markers back crossing, we have developed the our live varieties like Ankur Sonam, then Ankur 7042, Ankur 7434, and Ankur Rupali, resistant to the bacterial blight. That's all, sir. Thank you, sir. Hello.
Any problem?
नहीं सर आता दिखते ना?
Yes yes.
सर ज़्यादा presentation सुन. Hello. Sir, presentation dale. If any questions are there, kindly so that we can have the answer sessions.
Hello.
Haan, sir, bola.
Any question from student side? Chat box madhe baka, Sachin, the chat box la ahet ki.
Ahet ka, bar bakto, sir. So basically, from the it is going very fast, please try.
No, even carbon too. Any questions from student side? Hello.
Basically, this markers breeding is being can be used for the developing the entrepreneurs in the because now the if you are knowing the Atmanirbhar Bharat cha jo program hai tyachyasathi pan he markers can be used very nicely because it help us to develop our own labs and using those labs we can screen out the material at a commercial level also, and it is not so costly affair also, because the only thing is that you just know to have how it is, what is the technique behind this and how it is being used. Because now the nobody wants to do put their legs in the field, everybody wants to do in a lab only. So it can be the very good opportunity for the newcomers to set up their own facility and give the service provided to the any organization, so that they can do their work very essentially or the properly.
There is one question in chat box.
So this question has been how can the GBS techniques help in a breeding and genetic data study? Basically, GBS is the based upon the GBS, we used to this GBS for identification of the SNPs. That SNPs are the across genome, and that SNP is further utilized for the tagging certain gene or the trait of our interest, and so that these markers are these SNP markers can be further utilized for the our breeding program. Basically, GBS are used to identify the SNPs in the your germplasm line. That is main object of the GBS.
Hello, Dhanasri.
Yes, sir.
You can ask the question.
Sir, see, sir answered the question.
Okay.
Sir, one more question. Are there any institutes which provide sequencing help to the students? Like, if we want to sequence the data, are there any institutes which provide this aid for research work?
Yeah, there are too many institutes which are doing the sequencing. It's not a government institute, it's a private organizations, and you will find a number of organizations that are doing the sequencing on the costing best. So, and the sequencing is not too costlier also, it's a very cheap right now. So there are certain labs are there, like just like Eurofins is there, then Fireservice is there, then Genotypic Technology is there. These all are people are doing sequencing and for the consumers, and they are giving to us, and the quality of the sequence is also good in from coming from these labs.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Question is from Jagdale. No, Jagdale.
Which diseases caused by the SNPs? Yeah, there are number of diseases where the SNPs are linked. Just now we have quoted an example, just like in the bacterial blight in case of the rice, then bacterial blast in case of the rice, neck blast. These are all traits where the SNP markers are linked with the disease resistance. Also, there are certain traits like just like as the amylase contained in the rice, GC contained in the rice. These are all traits linked with the SNP. SNPs are nothing but the genetic variation present on the genome. This is the type of the markers, and this type of the this is the most recent one and most effective marker. That's what it is widely being used presently. So, in any trait, you can use to have SNP markers.
Just take the chat box present. Yeah, is anybody having any questions?
Hello, this is Hanumant Wadekar. हाँ सर बोला. हाँ सर माझा प्रश्न हा होता की सपोज एखाद्याला सीड इंडस्ट्री मध्ये यायचंय आणि नवीन व्हरायटी रिलीज करायचं, तर अशा एंटरप्रेन्योर मिनिमम काय गोष्टी गरजेच्या आहेत आणि मिनिमम कोणत्या गोष्टींपासून तो चालू करू शकतो अशा प्रकारचा सीड न्यू व्हरायटी डेव्हलपमेंट प्रोग्राम?
Sorry, I didn't get you properly. Can you please repeat once again?
Sir, जर मला एखादी मला सीड इंडस्ट्री खोलायची आहे, मग सीड इंडस्ट्री मध्ये पार्टिसिपेट व्हायचं किंवा चालू करायचे आहे, तर अशा कोणत्या गोष्टी माझ्याकडे पाहिजे ज्याच्याशिवाय मी सीड इंडस्ट्री मध्ये येऊ शकत नाही ऍज अ एंटरप्रेन्युअर?
ऍज अ एंटरप्रेन्युअर यू जस्ट नीड टू हॅव अ जर्मप्लाझम ऑफ दॅट पर्टिक्युलर क्रॉप इज मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टंट. बेस्ड अपॉन द जर्मप्लाझम लाईन्स यू नीड टू हॅव फर्स्ट, सो दॅट हॅव्हिंग प्रॉपर जर्मप्लाझम यू कॅन स्टार्ट युअर ओन ऑर्गनायझेशन.
सर हाऊ टू डेव्हलप दॅट जर्मप्लाझम? If I don't have any, so how can I start and how from where I can collect and all?
This is the very basic and there are number of breeding techniques to develop your breeding lines. Just like you can get an introduction, you can collect, you have a collection, you can introduction, you can have pedigree, back crossing, and the bulk segregant analysis. These are all techniques which can help us to develop your germplasm for particular crop.
Sachin, actually this question is related to how to set up the lab of the molecular biology which is required for the breeding program.
To develop our own lab laboratory, it's depend upon the how much the workload you are going to handle in a day or in a year. So depending upon that one, you basic facility lies a DNA extraction, then PCR amplification, it's a fluorescence analysis. These are the most important things which are required for the establishing a molecular biology lab. And once this has been done, then what are the subsidiary for that? This is you need to have a deep freezer to store the DNA material. You need to have the proper data analysis systems to handle the your data. These are the some basic requirements for establishing any lab. So if you are interested to know how to establish the labs depending upon the your budget, we can plan it out and we can help you in establishing the lab.
Okay, thank you sir.
Any question from students? Okay, hello. So if questions are, I think Jagdal is not okay. If no question is there, I will formally conclude this lecture with few words. Dr. Sachin Nikam has very nicely explained the beauty of the marker technology. He has told that what is mean actually physically and at molecular level marker is. And the beauty is that you can save the timing which has been spent in the conventional breeding, huge time, huge resources, those who are spending during the conventional breeding, which can be saved. And what is the another aspect of this marker technology is that there is an exactness while doing the work at the molecular level. So you can reduce the time frame of your research work. You can do it with more accuracy and you can go for the speculation of that particular gene behavior with the help of this marker technology. The screening of the parents, screening of the offscreams and or your that breeding population, that can be done in very short time frame. That is the beauty, and that was the in nutshell the conclusions of Dr. Sachin Nikam's today's lecture. So Dr. Sachin Nikam, we are thankful to you for sparing your valuable time for explaining these things to our participants. And on behalf of the Dr. Balasaheb from Kokan Vidyapeeth and being organizing secretary of this, particularly the online training program, I express my thanks to you and Ankur Seeds also that they have requested our honor. And in the future also, this association and cooperation will remain with us. With this assurance, I conclude my words here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for giving me opportunity because it's a very great pleasure because where you studied and you are expressing your knowledge. This is a great pleasure and thanks for giving me an opportunity.
Okay.
Thank you,
have
sir.
Have a nice time. Good day. All the participants, they are requested to give their feedbacks without fail. Please provide your feedback forms. Okay. Thank you. Have a nice day. Good day. Bye. End karu doctor.